Random House Audio presents A Week in Summer by Maeve Binchy. Read by the author. From a live recording at the Merriman Summer School in County Clare, Ireland.
When I was asked to read a short story, my first feelings were complete delight and excitement, because there is nothing as important as being recognised by your own. And even though I might not have attended every lecture when I was here, I've been coming here since 1968, coming to Clare for the Merriman Summer Schools. I've always thoroughly enjoyed them. Of course, I did say to Gordon on the day, it's all very nice now and I'll sit down and I'll think about it, but on the night, there will be a lump of lead in my stomach, and the question I will be asking myself is a cosmic, why did I agree to do this? Why couldn't I have come and listened to somebody else's lecture or had a big dinner or something like that? But I decided to write a short story, and so that you'd know it was written specially for you, for the Merriman Summer School, and so that you'd know that it was not something I took out of the bottom of a back drawer or anything. Its topic will let you know that at least this was written with the occasion of the bicentenary in mind. I'm not an actress, but I'll do my best to read the story, and the person who is telling the story is an American. But I won't embarrass myself or any Americans by putting on an American accent. I'll let them be pleased to know, but if you could imagine it as being spoken by an American woman. And I call the short story A Week in Summer. Do you know what I think should be banned outright? Those advertisements for cruise holidays for mature people. You get pictures of a suave man in a dinner jacket, hair lightly streaked with grey, looking into the eyes of a woman who has draped a pashmina stole around her slim, firm shoulders against the night breezes as they stand on deck together. There is a hint that they have been at it like knives all afternoon, and they can't wait for the captain's cocktail party and gala dinner to be over so they can be at it all over again. Are there people like this? Is this what people aspire to and therefore do? Or is it just a fantasy dreamed up by an advertising agency to sell holidays to us middle-aged Americans? Something that will leave the rest of us unsettled and unhappy. In any event, it's not important, it's not relevant to us. We've never had a holiday. Not even when the girls, Mel and Margie, were children. Brian used to say in his farming days, find me a cow that doesn't need to be milked for 3 weeks and then we'll have a vacation. And when the bottom fell out of the dairy cattle market, as it did, for Brian anyway, he was into growing corn in Illinois and flax in North Dakota. And in those days, you couldn't take a vacation either, because corn and flax always needed to be planted or watered or reaped or saved or something. And when the bottom fell out of flax and corn, as it did for Brian anyway, he studied mathematics and he became a maths teacher. Now, other teachers had vacations. In fact, people were always saying that they met teachers on holiday, but not Brian, because there were papers to mark or courses to do or slow children to help. And then he liked going up to the attic and writing little bits of poetry to himself, which he never showed to anyone. But anyway, what with all this, hey presto, the vacation was soon over. Me? Oh, I've worked forever at the same thing. Like my mother before me, I bake things. I used to work as a patisserie chef in a big hotel. But then when I met Brian, I had to think up something a bit more mobile, something that could move easily when he did. So I make cakes and casseroles and pies, and I deliver them to people's homes. I have to be ready to get up and go to the next place, so it was good to have a craft or a trade or a skill, whatever you might call it anyway, to take with us, because people everywhere want to eat, and lots of younger women aren't able to cook. You'd be surprised how many deep dish apple pies I make in their own pottery dishes. They even pretend to their husbands they cook them themselves, so I have to be very careful about the time I deliver them. Now, I know I could have had taken a vacation on my own, I agree. There was nothing to stop me from going to Europe or on a cruise or to the Grand Canyon. But that wasn't the point. I wanted to travel with Brian, and he didn't want to go anywhere at all. It wasn't just to say that I'd been somewhere. I'm way too old for that. My customers, who bought the deep dish apple pie or the lamb stew, wouldn't think more of me if I said I'd been on a cruise to Alaska or on a train through the capitals of Europe. No, I wanted it for Brian and for me, something to remember, something to look back on when we were old, during the long evenings when we were on our own. And we were on our own a lot. Mel and Margie were away. There was always something for them to do during the summer holidays when school term was finished. There was this camp and that camp, and children love camp. And because we had moved so much and so often, and Brian had so many careers, we thought it best for the girls to go to a residential school, give them more stability so they would be able to keep their friends. And heavens, they had so many friends. A lot of these friends had parents who were much younger than we were. We were conscious of being older parents. I mean, Brian was 40 when we married and I was 38, and we didn't want to be too geriatric with them. All parents live on different planets to their children, they say, and Lord, I've seen enough of that in the houses where I deliver food. But older parents, that's a solar system even further away. And anyway, why should the girls come and hang out around our house? What with Brian always so worried about everything, big lines of worry etched into his forehead, and me always up to my elbows in pastry dough. No, not much fun with us. And I remember back to my own childhood. I didn't want to hang around my house when I was young either. And I could go away with a lot of my girlfriends, all right. We're all in our 50s, but we think of ourselves as girls, and we always will. I don't want to spend our hard-earned money on a vacation. And I want with them, I want to be with Brian. I love Brian. I've always loved him since the first day I met him, with his dreams and his poetry and his hopes of changing a world. It didn't matter that he didn't earn much of a living. Nobody rated him very highly. He was the man that I always wanted and always will. You know, I can see him in a tuxedo, like the men in the advertisements. I can see us spending long afternoons in a bedroom or a cabin or a sleeping car compartment, wherever. I can see us exchanging a knowing glance that says that there'll be more of that later on. I'm not sure why, but I can see it very clearly. And Brian needs a holiday even more than I do these days. You see, he's just been suspended from his school. It's August now, and he hasn't any position for September when the school year starts. A man of 57 without a job. And all because he had to speak his mind. And what's more, he had to speak it at the Parent Teachers Association. It was an occasion for congratulating the school for doing so well, for concentrating on the positive side of things. Ah, no, my Brian had to choose this occasion to tell people that he didn't think the war in Iraq was a just war. This in a community that had already two men who died on active service in the Gulf War. They didn't even wait till the next day to tell him that his services would no longer be needed. The head came round to the house, said he was sorry, but feeling was running just a little bit too high. I'd only teach mathematics in future, poor Brian had promised. Too late, the head had said. It hit Brian very hard. He didn't want me to tell the girls. I don't mind you knowing I'm an all-time loser, he pleaded, but I don't want my daughters to know this, not yet. But Mel and Margie would have to know when it came September, when Brian wasn't returning to school, I told him. Oh, hey, honey, he said, they're not really all that interested in what I do or don't.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.